It was a painful, horrifying, and secret part of America's history during World War II. The U.S. government conducted experiments with mustard gas and other chemicals on some U.S. troops at the time. That chapter of history was first revealed in the early 90s. Now, a new investigation by NPR finds the military used race-based experiments as part of those tests. African-American men, shown here in protective gear, as well as Japanese-American and Puerto Rican soldiers, were singled out. These pictures show the forearms of men exposed to mustard gas and other agents. Some, like Rollins Edwards, are living with the effects decades later, including injuries to their skin. Caitlin Dickerson led NPR's investigation, and Susan Smith is a professor of history at the University of Alberta, Canada. She's studied and written extensively about this, and thank you both for being with us. Caitlin Dickerson, to you first, how did you hear about all this? What led you to the story?
So to explain that, Judy, I have to start by telling you that these tests were part of a much larger body of experiments that the U.S. military conducted during World War II involving around 60,000 enlisted men. I was looking into the Veterans Administration, who in the 1990s, when those tests were first exposed, promised to provide disability benefits to veterans who sustained permanent injuries in those tests. And in the course of reporting that story, which will air on Morning Edition later this week, we started to come across the names of studies that really stood out to us, things like comparison of the word Nisei, which means first-generation Japanese-American, to white soldier, comparison of the word they used then, Negro, to white soldier when exposed to mustard gas. Those were the first threads of evidence of these experiments that we found, started pulling on those, and then we came across Susan Smith's work, submitted requests to the federal government for original documents, and that's where it all started.
So, Susan Smith, you had been doing work looking into this. How extensive were these tests using mustard gas and other chemical agents?
Well, certainly there was a lot of medical research on chemical weapons for World War II, and the mustard gas experiments in particular, as Caitlin mentioned, some 60,000 American soldiers were used in experiments. But I was quite struck by the 9 race-based experiments that I located. There's at least 9. There could have been more, but in the published scientific records, I found the experiments on Japanese Americans, African Americans, and Puerto Ricans.
And Caitlin Dickerson, what was the effect of these experiments? We showed some of those photographs just now, but what did these experiments do to these men?
Sure. Mustard gas, it reacts with human DNA right away, within seconds of making contact, and it causes irreversible damage. So frequently you'll see things like chronic skin problems, including skin cancer, that never goes away. Rollins Edwards, who I interviewed in my story, he still, more than 70 years later, he still has thick scabs on his skin, which he scratches at until they bleed. Mustard gas also commonly affects the airways, so it causes things like COPD, emphysema, asthma. It can cause leukemia and eye disease, all kinds of very serious and sometimes life-threatening illnesses.
This is a man who's lived into his 90s, is that right?
That's true. So the veterans that I was able to talk to for this story are, of course, an exceptional group, having far outlived their life expectancy and having gone through this. We can assume that there are many more who aren't around to tell us their stories today.
Professor Smith, why was the government doing this? What were they trying to find out?
Well, the First World War had been a chemical war, and there was every expectation that the Second World War would be one as well. So the Allied governments, Canada, the United States, Great Britain, Australia, all prepared for a chemical war. This is also true of the Japanese and the Nazis in Germany. So chemical war was everyone's expectation, and the scientists were involved in helping with that research.
But why did they choose a number of African-American men, Japanese-American men, Puerto Ricans, and so forth?
And this is a really important question about how race matters in the world of science. The expectation was that racial differences would prove to play out not just for disease, but for toxic exposures of mustard gas. So the scientists themselves had assumptions that racial groups might be variable, and the expectation was that white soldiers would have one kind of response, but African Americans might be more resistant, Japanese Americans as well, and Puerto Ricans too, that there would be racial differences they could identify.
And Caitlin, what did they find out?
So when you look at the results of these experiments, there's a report that was written at the end of the war that does suggest military scientists continued to think that African Americans were more resistant.
Based on what they found?
Based on what they found. And we did show those results to a few different medical researchers and experts, but it's really hard to say anything about the veracity of the numbers because we just weren't there. And we know that the standards about experimentation on humans weren't up to the level that they are today. So they do suggest that at the time they thought African Americans were more resistant, but right after that they sort of follow up and say, but you know what, there's a lot of variation among these groups, maybe even more so than between them.
And again, just to underline, these men went willingly, is that right? All the people who participated?
That's not necessarily the case, and I'm glad you brought that up. It's important. When you look at all the documents surrounding military mustard gas experiments, the test subjects are referred to as volunteers. But we know even from a government study that was conducted back in the 1990s when the first sets of experiments were exposed, we know that the term volunteer isn't necessarily accurate, that in some cases men were asked to volunteer, but they weren't told what they were volunteering for, and they were offered incentives like a vacation or an award. The men that we interviewed for this story about race-based experiments, they say they were not volunteers. The military did not ask them, they told them.
Professor Smith, are there other experiments that were done at that time that have yet to be made public?
Well, certainly from the 1940s through the 1970s, there were many, many types of scientific experiments on human beings. Despite the Nuremberg Code coming out in 1947, the role of human experimentation in medical and scientific research was very important as a tool for scientists. What is interesting here is that we know about radiation experiments. We know about toxic exposures of Agent Orange later in the Vietnam War, but this is the World War II story that we don't know as much about, partly because we don't remember that it was preparation for a chemical war.
Well, it's just a striking set of findings and some remarkable research, and Professor Smith, and remarkable reporting. Caitlin Dickerson, we thank you both.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.